Dimple Kapadia ma'am, like, she has been a constant for you since the beginning.
Yeah, she just doesn't leave me. She's like a bad habit. Yeah, when Dimple turns around and tells me, like, you've seen Bobby. Why haven't, bastard? I was Bobby and you made me to Boba. You know, I've always had this ability to see humor in the darkest spaces. They come through in, I guess, the stories I tell. I recently saw this on Instagram, yeah.
Yeah, I know.
That's when I started following you. But I really think you write some very fucking sensible stuff. And I really like the recommendations you make. I followed a lot of them, which were quite worthy.
Well, in that,
yeah. Now, I can't remember what and all, but I remember. But then I said, oh shit, okay, I enjoy this. But that's why I thought it was a very new thing. So...
Yeah.
Anyway, I'm glad it's doing well, and I'm glad that your passion is finally translated into something that you can make a sort of life out of.
Yeah. And you know, that's what's interesting about, yeah, exactly, about the digital world, that, you know, that you can just start putting your stuff out without really having to wait to finance it.
No. That's the best part. The fucking democratic nature of it. And then there are many worst parts also, but we won't get into that.
No, I would love to know. I mean, for you, like, what do you think is like a bad part?
A bad part? I mean, look at what's happening here with this bad hardwiring happening to the youth of, and thinking that you have to live for this sort of anonymous external validation, and you know, this whole thing of. I mean, 60% of their making lives are on a screen in a world that is completely unreal.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, so somewhere you get sort of, the more you sort of go out of yourself, I think the more hollow you become. And sadly, kids don't have that guidance or the majority to think that way. So they just get completely fucked with this fucking system.
Yeah.
Anyway, on to more pleasant things like Saas, Bahu, or Flamingo.
Yeah, tell me about Saas, Bahu. It looks damn cool. What a cool premise for a show, and yeah, looks lovely, and what a cool title as well. To kind of take that whole that title that we have grown up with, that we've all grown up in. This title has become this template for all the entertainment-based news channels as well, right? Like the Saas Bahu, Saas-ish and all of that. So, and converted into like a drug-based show. Like, how did that come to you?
Actually, quite. Now that you've got into such detail, it's not with that thought of. I wouldn't mind taking credit for thinking of it in such a elaborate way. Unaware of the news channels having these things.
Well,
I didn't grow up watching any of this stuff. At a later age, was told, I learned of its popularity, and I learned of these Saas Bahu serials becoming very popular, but I don't think I've even seen one of them in my life. But what I did, I did know of its popularity, and I did know that it was a sort of slightly cliche, stereotypical way of portraying the mother-in-law, daughter-in-law dynamic, and about kitchen politics or whatever. This is like something I've been told, not gone into much depth with. But when I had that, and then as soon as I had an idea that, listen, I'm going to make a story about the women in the household who are running this sort of cottage industry in the middle of nowhere, and actually it's just a front, and actually they're running the biggest drug cartel in this side of the globe. And even the men in the family are unaware or oblivious of this. I just thought that was a great premise as a story. Never with the intention to make a statement about women, any of that. I mean, that for me was very organic. I mean, there's the stronger ones in the species. And I mean, there's the question of them not being the shredders in this madness.
No, yeah. But tell me something. I mean, you know, I really feel like there is this big disconnect in terms of how we talk about, like, let's say, because, again, since you have kept the Saas Bahu dynamic in some way at the center of your story, Even if it was unconscious or subconscious, I mean, it is there, right? And, you know, like, there is all this conversation about how the Saas Bahu serials are not really, have caused the decline of Indian television and all of that. But at the same time, I really feel like, you know, it's been 20 years, 25 years, and these are the shows that are still working, right? And these are the shows that still do the best on television, on when it comes to the traditional TV. So do you feel like, or was that also somewhere in your mind on some level that it could help you reach this very different audience that probably, I'm just saying, because, you know, no, but what
bad over? Not at all. My God, if I thought that much, I'd be a genius.
but geez, for me, you are a genius. For me, I get it.
What the hell is going on TV? I don't know half the stuff you said about these news channels and these TVs and all. I just knew that it was a phenomenon at one time. And that's about it. I went to a tongue-in-cheek, flip on its head, bang the fucking shit out of it and move on. That was it, yeah. In the boat, now I feel like I'm at one of those. I used to go for these film festivals, you know. And at these film festivals, you'd have some of these very sort of, you know, these very arty crowds and these art deco small theater in Paris where you'd be invited and showing up Being Cyrus. And I remember, in fact, when Being Cyrus was happening, it was damn funny. And this guy, these people, I mean, literally, it was like you're wearing some Andy Warhol party. I mean, it was sitting there, and there'd be some woman smoking with some long, fixed cigarette holder and some bouffant. The men with makeup, like everyone, like sitting up and analyzing a movie. And I remember after that, they were all speaking in French and everything interpreted for me and this lady. And they all loved the, just absolutely slapped it all up. And at which point they were like, oh, the Parsi community must have been very quaint for them and all. At which point, this guy, this one woman turns around and says, you know, I mean, she said it in French and it was interpreted, so I don't need to do the French accent. So I'm dying too, so she must.
You must. I should have to listen.
No, that she said, you know, it is absolutely fascinating that the character's name is Cyrus, which is the benevolent emperor, but actually his alter ego, which is truth, is Xerxes. And I said, fuck, I never thought about that. And that's the sort of subtext us filmmakers, you know, we keep it in the film, hoping that someone or someone else would pick up and catch. So I'm so glad I bought that. And I was like, oh my God, I didn't think of that.
but then, homie, isn't that what, like, in general, I can get a sense of, like, how you view these conversations around films. But isn't that what it's about eventually? Like, you put out a film and then it kind of becomes, it's not your own anymore, right? Like, it's...
Because midway through and it leaves you. Midway through, the bastard of a beast leaves you. And all your job is to hang on for dear life and keep riding it. That's becoming bigger and bigger and more rogue.
Yeah, that's the life of a film. But yeah, you're absolutely right. It becomes everyone's. And it's not made by one person. It's made by so many people collaborating. Correct. Got a little piece of all of them. Then it's sort of, then you've got your post-production that goes into another space. Then it goes into another space of when you're putting it out there. And finally, you are just the one hanging on and saying, hey, I'm the one who read it. But it's a very magical process. I mean, from where into where, and when you breathe life into characters who are just black and white on paper. It's a joy for anyone who enjoys telling stories, and I love telling stories. Because I can fucking talk to furniture till the cows come home, which my wife will tell you. As soon as I start a story, only when she learns for the 10th time, now she doesn't even realize, she just leaves very subtly. She just leaves the room, whether we had a party or anywhere. To retain my dignity and ours.
Yeah, yeah.
But saying that, it is that. It's art, yeah. At the end of the day, art is your interpretation of it. When you say the value of something that's hanging on a wall, I mean, really, what is the value? Yeah. It's the value of what emotion it instills in you and what takeaway is from it. The same thing with a story. It's how you process that, how you accept and consume a story, is then it becomes your story to me. That's what the beauty is of making movies.
No, but how did your love for like storytelling begin? Can you remember, like, were you a filmy kid while growing up, or
Not at all. I still have very much shitting. It's quite embarrassing when I hang around with people who make, breathe, eat films, and they make references, and I'm just, I don't know, intelligently, I have no idea what they're talking about. I was actually not at all a big cinephile. I love telling stories. I really enjoy telling stories. I love seeing true life stories in front of me. I would love travel. That's why I love traveling. I travel in all the most absurd ways. But, and for me, that actually created a bank of stories. I definitely think I picked it up from my father. My father had a penchant to tell very colorful stories. He's traveled all over the world. He was the head of this World Boxing International Federation. And at that time, I remember he used to go to places like Havana and you know, Okinawa, and like places we hadn't heard of really, but not really accessible. And I remember he used to come back, and when he'd come back with a treasure trove of stories. And he'd tell us about how he was in this boxing stadium and this suicide bomber came in to kill Fidel Castro, but blew up in the wrong section. And he was sitting, the way he'd tell you the story, you get drawn into that world. And you already did quick travel. Then suddenly the next day his friends would come over and he'd say the story again, and it's like, and by the time 5 days had passed, it was a very different story. With the common core was the same, the characters were the same, but the way he narrated it and the amount of, and I realized the way he's recalling the story is actually to it the way he feels it'll entertain his present audience to the optimum. And I remember, I was very young, and I remember telling him, I said, Dad, you're lying, yeah? The first day he told me the story, you're lying. And he got quite offended. And he turned around and he said, I'm not lying. I'm just adding color to my memory. So I said, what does that mean? So he said, you only have the present and you have your memories. Make sure they're colorful ones. Which frankly, in my mind, has been quite a way of justifying quite the exaggeration, but the ability to tell stories like that, I felt it was incredible. And you hear them over and over again. And then finally, they become great. They would become great memories of something that did happen. But the way it's interpreted, like we were talking about interpreting people's story, the way it would be finally interpreted would be the memory of your life.
I think
that's where I got it from. I think that's where I definitely got it from. I mean, he could keep a entire room completely enraptured with in the way he would spin his yards. But I enjoyed that. And I think I started looking at life with a very different lens. I mean, I've always had this ability to see humor in the darkest spaces.
Yeah.
And, they come through in, I guess, the stories I tell.
Yeah.
So I think the storytelling came from there. If I have to blame someone, it's my father.
No, I think that's a good blame to have. I think he'll be happy to have that blame. But no, tell me, when did you feel like, if especially since you're saying that you weren't really especially a filmy kid growing up.
Not at all.
When did you realize that like films are the medium that you want to choose in order to tell your stories?
You know, I didn't. I actually, I remember watching the Paran's Chata.
Oh, okay.
Paran was in college with us. I remember watching that movie, and that was the first time I really identified with. I never used to watch many movies, so when I saw that movie, I said, wow. So I could see strains of influences in our lives in that film. How they must have influenced you by that time. And at that point, I felt that shit, I think I can do this. I mean, I could make a movie, I guess. I mean, I was saw what it intended. And then I was, anyway, it sort of stuck in my head. And then I was a scuba diving instructor. I used to pretty much visit Lakshadweep and live there. And then I'd come back, and a friend of mine, Casey Kabata, had given me this. We used to write articles for websites on travel and humor. But on websites and on magazines and all. And I remember that time he came with this article. Fictional tale of Being Cyrus. Ed Bejar, and he said that, dude, you know, read this, it's been rejected by a magazine because of the profanity. And I remember reading it and very instinctively I said, I'm going to make this a movie. And that's exactly, everyone laughed and said, oh, there he's up to one of his bad, quirky ideas. Because he's doing things like that. I take it up a key to Venice, the second biggest art festival.
Yeah.
Which they made in the movie, I think. And,
yeah.
So imagine that was not me. That's quite bizarre. That,
yeah,
that I experienced in my life.
Okay.
So anyway, so I should do all this. And and I remember I said I'm making a movie. Everyone said, yeah, and literally in 6 months I was shooting Being Cyrus.
Oh wow. So you didn't really do the regular hustle that people have to go through where they're ADing on sets and all of that.
I've worked on one film like that, which was because I used to see, after I left college, I wanted to become a diver, a commercial diver. That didn't, I made a lot of training, and I met a lot of guys who I think 25 at the time, because it was a quick gig. It was a very dangerous gig. You did it for 15 years, you earned a shit ton of money, and you retired. And as a 20-year-old, I couldn't have thought of anything better. Spend a lot, what did I just do that?
Yeah,
but then I met a lot of divers who said, if you ever have to do it again, we never do it again. You're experiencing a lot of health issues.
Correct, more correct.
The pressure on this and that and blah, blah, blah. The other thing I did was, during the summers in college, I used to work for a guy called Mahesh Mathai, who used to make ad films. And Mahesh used to make ad films, and I used to be literally like I'd get them extras for an ad, which would be on college friends. I'd be like a goofball. I'd run around and I'd freelance and I'd earn something.
All right.
And basically try to get through my summer like that. And so when I decided not to be a diver, I decided to ask him that, hey, do you think I could join your company and make films? And he agreed. And I realized that I had a pretty natural, because I had never studied filmmaking, I had a very natural visual sense and a very good idea on edit, on scripting, on when I'd be at, though I was a gopher, I would be running around getting his coffee, I'd be sitting on the rough cuts, I'd be getting extras, I'd be doing everything. And then my dad died suddenly, and I was 8 months into the job, and I had to leave. And then I left, and then that was the last I ever experienced of film. Experience, except when he decided to make a film called Bhopal Express, where we were, he called me up and he said, do you want to be my assistant? And it was very funny because I was his DA. Zoya Akhtar was the second AD. What's his name? Apurva Nakhia was the first AD. Nakul Kapte is one of his first Sing Sound films. I mean, it was legendary. We were so badly behaved. I don't know how we made that movie ever. We had the best time ever. We had such good fun. But nice. It was such a bad experience. And I remember, wow, that's the only experience I had on a film set. And finally, I remember, in fact, the video assist guy who carries, and at that time, there was the small Teranex. There was a big, heavy, like a TV, was your video assist on set.
Correct, correct.
Real lot. And that guy was an old guy. So once I helped him move it, and then I got stuck. So then finally, my designation from being a director's assistant became the video assistant. Oh. And I was just carrying this big tomato. We had a lot of fun. And I think that's the most important thing. But so, I've not had much experience in that. That's one I've not had much experience in at all. But I'm very, I remember things very visually. Like, if I meet you, I'll remember you probably in different bags. I may not remember what you spoke about, but visually, I'll remember you in different bags. I think that's what happens to me. So for me, when I wrote the first story, I said, how difficult can it be? So when I picked up this Being Cyrus thing, I said, how tough can it be? Finally, I mean, I know what I want in my head. I have to find technicians who can put what's in my head on the cellular. That's what probably the shoe star is all about. And I did that. It was received very well. It
you know, all these horror films and all. And I put my lungi on and I went back to Mexico and I said, chal, let me go back to diving.
Very nice, nice.
Then I got called by Dinesh Rajan, who, you know, very funny. Dinesh Rajan was a banker at that time.
Oh, is it?
And he came as, it was his first time he was producing. And I was the scuba diving instructor, and it was the first time I was making a film. And we were both conning each other that I knew how to direct and he knew how to produce.
Got
it. So we both were trying to just, yeah, of course, you know what's happening. You don't want to do anything. Huh?
Yeah, yeah.
You don't want to do anything. But I was very good at my narration. I remember because every actor did not ask twice. They just said, we are on. And strangely, they never asked me, have you done anything before? I mean, I sometimes asked Nasir, I said, I remember asking Nasir, I said, how come you never asked me?
bro, I thought you were an absolute baker.
I said, never, I've never been adding the light.
Oh, God.
Yeah, so it was quite bad. It was not bad. Everyone died. It's only bad, actually, for me. And I hope most people can have that kind of security. I have never... I have only done things that have put me in a... I've done things that are not in my comfort zone. And I think I always choose a project or a film to do if I feel I don't know how to do it. I'm not excited about if you tell me, hey, make a Being Cyrus part 2 or Cocktail part 2.
Correct.
I've moved on. I have one life. I have this much time. I want to fill it with pure joy and love. And
yeah,
I want the mad experiences. I love them. I love that uncertainty and that craziness. That's all it is about. I don't try to overanalyze it. And so when I make a film, also, it's not that I've sat and actually analyzed, oh, I'm going to do this to the Saas, Bahu, or Flamingo. It's something that has come very instinctively to me in that phase of my life. Or then phase of my life. And I mean, if I do carry on with the idea of it, it'll have to go into a more tougher space for me that I can't, that I'm uncomfortable. It can't be something I know.
Correct. And also, do you think about like the business making, like the money making aspect of it while making?
Oh, no. Not at all. Not at all.
And you haven't ever had to kind of compromise with the storytelling because it had to be made a certain way.
Yeah. Of course. You know.
What the thing I right?
100%. In fact, on this also, I had to certainly buy. I think my budget had gone a little far too. So finally, I was supposed to shoot at some other place and all that. I ended up shooting at the outskirts of Bombay to finish off some doc sequence.
Okay.
But frankly, now that I think about it, works so well that I wonder sometimes if we overthink and overspend for no reason. Even we can be way more conscious about it.
Yeah. No, but you know, like Being Cyrus, Cocktail, and even Finding Fanny, they're like, three films for
interesting. I just guessed how much Being Cyrus cost. With the actors, with everything.
Including the actors?
Everything.
I mean, for that time, I'm guessing 5-6.
1.84 crores.
Are you serious?
Yeah. Everything.
That's crazy.
And then finally, Dinesh Jusadra and I were carrying. We had no money. We were carrying those physical reels and going for film festivals where we were invited. And obviously, Master was 10 years younger than me, but somehow we would have some back problem all the time. So I would end up carrying some reels. And you remember those film reels?
Of course.
Some of them I'd be carrying with a bag. Clip this. I said, you fucker, you're 22. And as soon as we reached back, there was no slip disc.
When you write that shit on the carpet,
laugh about those times. So much fun. I was so fearless in a way because honestly, I mean, when you have absolutely nothing to lose, bro, you're learning. You go, everything's just very free and beautiful.
Yeah. I mean, also the fact that you made it in English, which again, I mean, at that time there was a phase of like English language films being made, but I think it kind of.
There was no base, nothing.
No, I mean,
but you know, lucky that multiplexes had just cropped up at that time.
Acha.
That was all it was. I think PVR had just come up at that time, and that's why we managed to, they managed to make this thing. The producers turned around and said, no, no, we've broken even, or they gave through some fucking, you know, these guys who chuck in very terms that you have no clue where they've originated from, but they sound very complicated, so it would feel like you don't want to ask. And there's the optimal cost cut sort of, I don't want to say, okay, believe you.
Yeah. But Homi, do you think, like, I mean, it's crazy to me that, you know, what you just told me about the cost of the film. And this is something because I am also an aspiring filmmaker, and, you know, these are just questions that I'm continually grappling with about, you know, the kind of money that goes into making films, etc. And then you come here and you tell me that, you know, you made that amazing film within that budget, and you see an example like Moonlight, or, you know, Everything Everywhere All at Once, and all of these are films that are
brilliant.
You know, it's like, yeah, they're amazing films. They've won Oscars and everything, and they were made with such short budgets. Do you feel like the way that, like, commercial filmmaking especially has become in today, or has always been, like, do you think that complicates things a lot, where in terms of, it feels like a certain amount of money has to be put and things have to look a certain way? Like, for example, if Being Cyrus, the exact same film was being made today with you having done all the work that you've done, would it have been a very different film just because
of course,
a certain way?
Of course it would. Absolutely it would. Because the fact is that, I mean, one is the, you're making it in a certain way because of where you are in life kind of thing. And it was not easy. It was a struggle making Big Cyrus. And then you reach a certain point, you get a certain amount of recognition or whatever. You start getting paid a little more to do your next gig. And you're like, I'm done with the struggle. I don't want to struggle again. But there's something brilliant that comes out of a struggle.
That makes sense. Makes sense.
You know? But you don't want to go through it again. It's like when between 20 and 30 years, my ass off in the most wild places, literally on a shoestring. I mean, I had no money. I would like literally be. I think I slept on more benches at roads in Vietnam and Greece and all these places than I slept in beds. But that was the education at that time, and I realized that if you're broke and happy, you can't be happier.
I am.
So somewhere, that what comes out of a struggle or what comes out of a time like that, you can't compare, but then you change in life also. You know, today, if you tell me, hey, Homi, do you want to go and stay with the Vietnamese family in the Mekong Delta for a month on nothing except love and fresh air, means I don't care. Now I want to stay in a 5-star hotel.
Yeah.
You know? So it depends where you are in life and what, but yeah, you're right. You can't, and sometimes you can. It really depends on who you are at that time. You know, for me, it's always been some which voice has been shouting loudest in my head, that person is worth the movie at that time.
Mm.
So yeah, I mean, if you, but you're right, a small budget film will only happen in the beginning. You're not going to find a experienced filmmaker who's put his shit in for years and for decades and suddenly going to say, Yeah, I don't buy it like a college student. I'm going to go back and make my movie. Oh, man.
Yeah. Of course.
That's just a luxury.
Yeah. But, you know, another thing that, I mean, of course, I love all of your films so much. I'm looking forward to the show so much. But, you know,
you will love the show. I promise you, you will love the show.
I'm sure.
That was very bizarre for me to be saying this because I made it. But, you know, when I work on a film, I'll tell you exactly that, for example, even a cocktail or a, you know, whatever, you know, as the maker, what you do is you have to fucking go over and over that footage over and over again. So you're watching a rough cut, then you finalize a rough cut, then after that you're watching the same footage while you're doing your music, same footage while you're doing your sound design, same footage while you're doing your grading. Then it just goes on. Finally, you've seen the damn thing about 30, 35 times. And you're fuck out with your own stuff. You have to act out. I'm enthusiastic and all that you're screening. But mostly, it's so many times when you're falling asleep. And, but bizarrely, in this bad show, I couldn't stop watching it with the same enthusiasm that I stopped, saw it the first time. So something must be up with this shit. I don't know what it is, but I remember, and I'm not someone who watches television or anything much. And I remember I finished, lined up the rough cut, and I said, okay, I'm watching it now for mistakes or whatever. Then a week on that. And I had a meeting with some actors for my next project, and I was in the theater in the office downstairs, and I told them to put on episode 6. And I could not stop watching. I saw 6, 7, 8. I binge watched the whole thing, knowing exactly what happens, everything, but I just couldn't stop. And I was just like seeing new stars going on, other stuff was happening, and I came out of there, went to the meeting, apologized for being horrifyingly late, which I'm never. And I said, guys, I need 10 minutes to just rest. So they're like, shit, what happened? I mean, I look like I'd been fired or something. Like, you're fired. Get out of bad films. And I said that I've just watched the last 3 episodes of my show. And it's the roller coaster from head that I think next time slapped me in the face with a pan. And they were like,
that's so cool.
They're talking about your own show. And I said, yeah, it sounds really bizarre. It's a story. It sounds like bias, but it is, there's something about this. I don't know if it's the energy with which it was made, the collaboration of how we all came together and what we went through. I remember telling my wife at that time also when I came back, and she was not working on this. I say it's an experience I've had. I mean, it was so ironic that the whole show was on a very dystopian kind of family drama. And offset, we were living the most utopian life, like a solid family, whether it was cast or crew. When we were all there for each other, there was so much love going around. It was really unbelievable. 4 months, we just became so, it just became beautiful. It was difficult. I actually thought, when we come back, hey, can we extend this kind of energy to the world at large? But of course not. As soon as you get into the city, you get sucked down into a black hole.
Yeah,
but somewhere I remember telling her, I said, you know, I think you've done something very special. And she said, please, you know, she's that. And she said, please just this keep your mouth shut, then boom, talk all of this. Let it come off, we'll see what happens. But regardless of what happens, I'm so enriched for the experience, from the experience. That for me is a victory. I mean, really, the experience we had, the friends we made, the love we shared, you don't get that. It was very sort of special. I mean, you don't get that every day on any film set or anything. And I think, I hope.
I'm sure. I love the trailer, and I'm so looking forward to. I wish I could see it before talking to you, but there wasn't enough time. But I will watch it for sure, and I'll let you know as soon as I watch it. But yeah, I'm so looking forward. Yeah,
please do.
And, you know, like, yeah, I was just going to say, you know, Dimple Kapadia, ma'am, she has been a constant for you since the beginning.
Yeah, she just doesn't leave me. She's like a bad habit. Yeah, that's a good way.
No, so, like, what is this equation exactly? Like, did it start with Being Cyrus, or did you know her before? And how has it sustained for so long? Matlab, itna to, matlab, Scorsese or Daniel Dra, jitna aapko aur Dimple, ma'am, chal raha hai.
I'm just wondering if you're referring to my age like a bitch.
it's like a rich. It's a rich body of work comparison, not the age one.
No, she is. I tell you, the first time I met her, which you'll love the story, I was with Big Cyrus and they told me to. They said, no, for this role, we should cast this actress called Dimple Kapadia. I was, of course, a naive idiot who had heard of Dimple Kapadia but not seen anything. And I still haven't seen any of her work.
You had seen Dil Chahta Hai, no? You had seen Dil Chahta Hai.
Dil Chahta Hai. That was the only one. But like when Dimple turns around and tells me like, you've seen Bobby. Why haven't? Bastard. I was Bobby and you made me to Boba. Maybe I didn't ask that I would find me back you just this time.
Yeah.
No, but she, so when I walked into her house, I remember, for to play Katie Setna from Being Cyrus, I remember walking in, and she was, the guy opened the door and she was backing me. She was bent over and she was hurling abuse at this small, you know, one of those yappy furry dogs. She was hurling abuse at this dog underneath the treadmill. And I just watched this for a while, and then she got up and suddenly realized I was there. And she just looked at me and she said, "Boy, you've come. You want coffee or tea?" So I'm like, yeah. And she said, "But any daughter's dog, yeah, I'm babysitting. My staff under my treadmill, bastard. So, where is this movie?" And I said, "Fuck, this is the character, man. You don't have to wait. Oh, babysit, na." That was our first meeting. What a memorable meeting. Seeing a people screaming and abusing a dog under a treadmill.
Yeah, yeah.
It made vulgar profanity. And the dog didn't give a shit. It just did a shit. It didn't give a shit. So I loved that. And the thing is, we are very similar in terms of our core values. Idea that we want to make an experience. Every experience needs to be rich and special and beautiful. She's like a child chasing a laugh. And I think that's, they're very similar in that sense. So the second film, which was...
what was my second film? Cocktail.
Cocktail, she really didn't have a part, but she said, "Yeah, I want to do it. I really enjoyed being here." After that, then suddenly it became... in Finding Barry, I had a small room for her, which I loved. And, I mean, now it's, like, she really didn't have much of a moment in Angrezi, but she enjoyed the experience.
It was still, you know, the nice part.
Yeah, yeah. But she was like, "I don't give a shit what you do. I mean, tomorrow, if you don't have a word for me, I will do a crossing in the background. But I want to be on set with you for a while because I have the best time ever." And I have the privilege of her trust, and that allows her to be very secure in terms of acting. So I can really pull out something very different from her every time, because she's willing to push the envelope. She's not inhibited in any way. And that's the relationship we share. And also, she never let the friendship cross into the professionalism of our director-actor relationship. So when we're working at set, that's how we may chuck a few abuses at each other and have a laugh, but we know exactly where that line is drawn, where we can get the best out of each other. So I mean, why fix it if it ain't broke?
Yeah, yeah. So I think I'll just end on one last question. Do you have any shows that you've loved that also maybe kind of, you know, maybe served as an inspiration for you to get into showmaking now? Were there any shows like that?
One, well, I barely watch anything. I look at your very Instagram handle to get some recommendation once in a while. So I'm the worst guy to ask, but I recently watched Beef, which I really enjoyed.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
I really enjoyed Beef. And if you're asking me what shows that I've watched in the past, I enjoyed Patal Lok and Mort. Dali, everyone tells me, considering you're making the show, you should have seen. I've not seen Breaking Bad.
Oh, you haven't?
No, man.
I think I'm wrong.
I've just not managed to go past. I've tried to watch it a couple of times. Actually, everyone tells me just wait and knock down 4 episodes and you're ready. But you know, I'm not much of a consumer of the visual medium. I don't sit. As soon as my wife puts the TV on, I'm asking. It's like a sleeping pen for me.
So what?
She puts it on and sometimes she says, "What should we watch today?" And if I give some suggestions, she's suddenly like, "I don't know why I actually asked you that, because you're going to go to sleep before the opening credits end." I remember loving Patal Lok. I remember enjoying, what did I recently watch? Shit, yeah. I can't even remember, that's the sad part. But my last outing was Beef, which I watched when I was shooting Murder Mubarak, and I really enjoyed that.
Okay.
Like the madness of it. What else? Show wise, no, I'm sorry. I watched Saas for Flamingo. Fantastic. Watch it on 50 plus on Star on the 5th of May, am I right?
I think so. But yeah, Homi, so, so cool to talk to you. So nice to have this chat.
Super talking here. I hope you make a movie soon and get that shit out of your system.
Yeah. I will. And I'll share the film with you whenever I make it. And let's meet. I live in Delhi, Vaise, but I would love to catch up sometime.
Yeah, I was already in Delhi for 2 months.
I know. At that time, I was in Bombay. So,
are you basically avoid me?
Yeah,
I got it.
I just want to do it on Zoom and, just want to get like a virtual relationship. I think is too much.
Okay,
I'll text you and all the best for the show, and I can't wait to watch it. I'll text you after watching it.
Thank you so much. Thank you
for joining us, Homi. Bye bye. Take care.
Yeah.